After 3 years away, Hollywood's King of Comedy is about to burst back onto the big screen. And in a programme that contains some strong language, Omnibus, now on BBC One and in widescreen, reveals the complex character of Steve Martin.
Beautiful day, isn't it, Ron?
Oh, it's great, Steve. Gorgeous. Yeah. Hey, what have you been up to?
Oh, the BBC is doing a documentary on me.
Uh-oh.
What do you mean, uh-oh?
Well, I mean, it's a BBC. They can be brutal.
They can? They love Hollywood actor types, right?
Oh, they love them. Look, come on, you know, they're going to dig for the dirt.
I don't have any dirt. What are you talking about? Well, the one thing, they're not going to find out about that.
Look, I'm scaring you. I'm making you nervous. It'll be fine. What's it called?
It's called Steve Martin Slimeball from America.
Think you can cancel?
Well, I've already paid them.
Just have fun with it.
Fun?
Such an American icon. I mean, everybody knows him from yards away. Steve is a total American entity for me. He's like the Beach Boys to me. He's a totally American thing that couldn't have happened anywhere else.
We obviously have mutual control over our body.
Our body? It's my body. I'm not sharing my body with anyone.
Everybody's going to be real disappointed.
He's number one as a comedian and film star because he is the star of movies. And he's very, very funny. A lot of comedians are funny, but they're not the star. He's also the romantic star. He gets the girl. Comedians never get the girl.
There's a tiny word. It's not a noun. It's not a verb. It's not an adjective. I don't know what it is, but if you said it to me tonight, all this blackness would go away, and you and I would be connected by a tunnel of light.
What is the word, Chris?
Yes.
That's the other side of him I think you've only seen a couple of times, the romantic side of him, which is great. And his rhythms are amazing because he can go from pure comedy rhythm to, you know, deep, deep depression within seconds. Because I think he can play anything.
Well, Roger, the BBC is doing a documentary on me. You know they're gonna try and find out my dark side. See, all comedians are supposed to have a dark side. I just hope they don't discover the nature of our relationship.
No.
Just don't answer any questions.
I think my talent is in my perseverance and hard work.
Yeah, it'll be okay.
Because I didn't have any special gift. And I'll say that to anyone out there who thinks they need a special gift. Focus and a little bit of obsession helps. And I thought, when I was young, I thought, there'll be a changing of the guard. And someone's going to take over. Why not me?
Ambush, you little four-footer!
With his distinctive white hair, Steve Martin is America's most recognizable comedian. His often absurd humor has kept him in the public eye for nearly 25 years.
Marie!
The star of some 20 films after making his debut with The Jerk, he has worked non-stop in cinema.
No, I just told him.
And Martin has not only performed in, but written some of his best movie moments.
Here it comes! 3D coming at you!
His new film is Bowfinger, and he plays the title character, an out-of-luck movie producer. The film has been acclaimed in America and revitalized interest in his long career.
I always believed that light comedy was what I wanted to do. I was a little bit torn because when I went to college and I sort of understood, whatever you want to call it, modernism or being new, I knew I had to be new. But I also wanted to make films that would be playing 20 years from now on a local channel, and somebody would be at home and they would just go, oh, and sit down and watch it and laugh.
He has an actor's approach, and during the acting, he can't help seeing the funny side. And then he bursts out and becomes the comedian. And then it goes farther and farther because it becomes almost uncontrollable.
You were saying?
Well, I think that the...
Ruprecht! May I take your trident, sir?
Yes.
In Dirty Rotten Scoundrels, the whole of Ruprecht was him improvising.
I think the...
Ruprecht, don't take the cork off the fork.
Why is the cork on the fork?
To prevent him hurting himself and others. Ruprecht, eat your applesauce.
He deals in embarrassment. Like in Planes, Trains and Automobiles, is when he wakes up in bed. Is that when he's traveling across with John Candy? He wakes up in bed with John Candy, and immediately his voice goes an octave deeper and he starts talking about football and baseball scores. Very macho dialogue, which I thought was funny.
Belle.
Huh?
Huh? Why did you kiss my ear?
Why are you holding my hand?
Where's your other hand?
Between two pillows.
Those aren't pillows.
See that Bears game last week?
Yeah, hell of a game, hell of a game. Bears got a great team this year.
You know, sometimes I'm funny in the movies, and then and sometimes I'm not funny with my friends. So, you know, the funny ball is just kind of bouncing around, and sometimes you're in public, and sometimes you're not. But there's nothing like being funny. There's nothing like having that feeling of really saying or being internally funny.
All right, Ben, faster! The Army needs these vehicles.
But Sergeant Bilko wasn't funny. A disastrous remake of the 1950s TV show, it left him disillusioned enough to rethink his career.
Sergeant! Sergeant Bilko! Fall in, men, now! And get into a semicircle, hi, or rectangle, now! Hi, hey!
I made a movie called Sergeant Bilko. And I thought, I shouldn't be doing this. Something was missing in, I felt lost with what I was doing. I thought, this doesn't feel funny. I don't feel funny. And that's when I stopped. And I was even offered a couple of films that were written for me. And I said, I just can't work right now. I'd feel cheap. I'd feel like I don't know why I would be doing it. I need to go away for a little bit.
After the failure of Bilko 3 years ago, Martin chose not to star in any films. Instead, he focused on his own writing, producing his first play, Picasso at the Lapin Agile, and the script idea that became Bowfinger.
And I kind of rekindled my spirit. And I was having success with writing for The New Yorker and the plays and et cetera.
It should have been who then flipped on the TV and was absorbed by it. Oh well.
And it kind of got my confidence up. And that's when I decided to write Bowfinger. I knew it was the time. It was the end of the millennium. You know, I'd been a celebrity essentially for 25 years. And I felt I really had something to say with comedy.
Yeah, get me Kit. No, get me Kit right now.
How many pictures we got in the pipeline?
You don't put me on hold, I put you on hold. You put me on hold and you're a dead man. Oh, man. Hey, Jerry, how are you? Bobby Bowfinger, Bowfinger
yeah,
Films.
Right.
We worked together on that thing, you know, a couple of years ago.
What thing?
The famous movie.
Hey.
Oh, hi, Kit. How are you?
My man.
I think the importance of Bowfinger is that it's remotivated Steve, but he is noticeably more picky about making movies than he was at our lunch 10 years ago when he just wanted to work because he felt this was the time of his life when he should be working. Now I think there has to be a real reason to make a movie. And I think Bowfinger's given him that.
Bowfinger, Steve Martin's first self-penned film for 5 years, satirizes Hollywood, the dream factory he knows only too well. As writer and star, he is involved with every stage of the production.
Bowfinger's finished. It is now in the press screening stage. There's a screening tonight in New York for press. They always put a real audience in there with them so they can get a feeling of how it plays. And I might stop in, I might not, I don't know, just to see, check in for 15 or 20 minutes.
It was just time to take a risk. You know, I hadn't really taken a risk since my plays. Little risks, you know, like venereal disease. Well, I'm kind of on vacation. I've just been to Venice, came back. I'm stopping here because I have an apartment here, see some friends. I'm gonna go back to LA on Saturday to do some more interviews for the New York Times and LA Times. I have a lot of friends here that I get to see that I don't get to see unless they're in LA. So it's good to come here. It's like having a whole different set of clothes. Well, Hollywood people are pretty good. The trouble is, when I come here, I have to hang around with artists.
Steve's white hair is the image of Steve's character, his persona, that recurs in his movies. There's more depth to the character he plays in Bowfinger. You know, but it's still that same, the jerk grown older, you know, he's got, why is he, he's still out for the big moment, the big dream. And that's what's nice about Steve's characters. Instead of like Woody's characters are all like smarter and wry about failure, Steve's always have this sort of wonderful optimism that maybe tomorrow is going to be better.
Gotta have you sign.
Sign? I ain't signing shit.
It's all good, it's all good. It's script is butter.
What?
Butter. This stuff is butter. It's all good. It's a Jiggy Baby. It's
Wait, hold
it's
now.
How you know it's all good in Jiggy Baby? Well, I was reading it on the way over. I hope you don't mind.
You read my script.
Yes, and you know what I loved about this script? It's a twist on the usual. It's science fiction, which we know sells.
Hey, shut up.
But also,
no, you shut up. You shut up. Let me tell you something, because I'm getting ready to whip your ass. Let me tell you something. You don't be reading my stuff, all right? Now get off the property.
I just got a little excited. That's okay.
I wanted to write about Hollywood as I saw it and as it was. And one of the things it is desperate. That there's, you know, the core of movie makers who are successful and powerful and at the dinner parties. And then there's this corona of hopefuls and people who are almost there with talent, people with talent who can't quite get in the door. And it's a mystery. And it's the way I was when I started. I didn't know anything about show business or how to get in it or who to see, what door to knock on.
Steve Martin was born in Waco, Texas in 1945 and moved with his parents and older sister to Garden Grove in Southern California when he was a young boy. His father, Glenn Martin, worked in real estate in Orange County, which is in the heart of suburban America.
I'm Melinda Dobbs, I'm Steve's older sister, and we're filming this in front of the home we grew up in Garden Grove, California. We moved in 1955, the same year that Disneyland opened. It was a real neighborhood. We had lots of friends in the neighborhood. It was a lot of fun living here. We had all the opportunities to be at Disneyland, which Steve took real advantage of. He had a job over there when he was 10 years old, selling guidebooks. There were days that he would make maybe 10 or 15 cents, but he loved being at Disneyland. It was his escape, I think, from things that went on at home.
To all who come to this happy place, welcome. Disneyland is your land. Disneyland is dedicated to the ideals, the dreams, and the hard facts that have created America.
It was just really fun for a kid. And it was show business. You were in show business when you worked at Disneyland. You wore a little outfit and you had a presentation to make, some, you know, being wholesome.
Disneyland was really his home away from home. But he had a father who was a frustrated actor. So it was in Steve's blood to be a performer. It was something that he had to do. And Steve was, from the time he was a child, he was so intense with what he wanted to do. And I had no idea that he was going to turn into what he has.
At home, he was very quiet. He never spoke much to his parents or his sister. There wasn't much camaraderie within the family. But when he got to Disneyland or to school, then he'd break loose. And all the time we were growing up together, he'd come to our house and he'd be outgoing and fun and doing comedy things. But he'd go home and he'd be kind of reclusive. Go to his bedroom and practice his magic tricks at first and then banjo later on.
Learned a lot of my beliefs about show business or my intuition about it from watching a show at Disneyland consistently three or four times a day starring Wally Boat. And he was a fabulous comedian. He was open. He was just funny. And I used to love to watch him. And my dream when I was 12 was that he would be sick and I would have to go on for him because I knew all his lines.
My name is Pecos Bill, and I'm the roughest, toughest critter in the whole Wild West. And I'd like to show you a few of the different draws you see all the cowboys do these days. First of all, there's the regular draw.
Bang!
And then, of course, there is the double draw. Mm. That's sometimes called a pair of drawers.
Steve and his family used to come to Golden Horseshoe quite often. He used to come backstage and wanted to be a comic. And we would go through scripts, and I'd would pull down some of my old gag files. Old gag files. Oh, it's so hot in here when I mention that. Oh, pardon me, who needs it? But I said, you're gonna need to pay for some material. So for $2, I charged him. I gave him about 8 pages of good stuff out of my gag file, and he used some of it. What's he been doing lately? But I was dumbfounded by him, some of the things he wanted to do. I remember we did a benefit show that I got together through the Disney organization. It was called Vaudeville Revisited. It was November 17th, 1961. And it says right here, props, Steve Martin. Now, a year later, we did the same type of show, and it was called The Son of Vaudeville. And by that time, he had gotten himself a magic act where everything went wrong. And I say he was ahead of his time because for a finale, he wanted to drop his pants and show off his jockey's shorts and run off stage. Well, you could do that now.
Even though Disneyland was a major, major part of Steve's life, as he was growing and developing his talent, he became obsessed with the banjo. And he would play his banjo, teaching himself to play it by the hour in his bedroom. And that's all he was doing. I would hear these same banjo chords played over and over. And I thought he was nuts.
I learned it by taking 33 RPM records and slowing them down to 16 and picking out the banjo songs note by note. And I would down-tune the banjo to be in the same key as the slowed-down record. And I would just keep playing it over and over and over until I got it.
I would say that in day-to-day life, Steve was the brunt of a lot that went on here. And it was probably because as he was evolving into the comedian and the actor and the writer, there was a lot of jealousy on the part of our dad. And he was extremely critical of Steve. He never, ever complimented him to his face. And so Steve, I think, went through a lot just trying to get approval.
I don't want to sit and criticize my father because it's hard to raise kids. And I don't have criticism of him. I have maybe criticism of myself, you know, for all of us. I mean, nothing's perfect. But I think there was a failure to encourage, let's put it that way, in the direction of the arts. Now, whether if I had been encouraged, I would have gone into business, I don't know.
When Steve was 18, he moved to Knott's Berry Farm, another theme park like Disney in Southern California, continuing his show business education.
There was a theater there, and we did four shows a day. It was a melodrama theater, performing this little comedy. And then afterwards, they had a little, what they called oleo acts, and I would go out and do 5 minutes or less, playing the banjo, doing jokes. I started my magic act there. I think Knott's Berry Farm was as important as Disneyland in my development as a comedian, entertainer, because that's when I really first got up in front of an audience. And there is nothing like the education of being in front of an audience four times a day. That's where you learn it.
Since those formative years, Steve Martin has remained living in California and spends his time between Hollywood and his weekend home in Santa Barbara.
I find that this is a good getaway because it's along the coast, and I find that there's a certain calm that overcomes one. You know, I've said as I get older, two things become very important. One is the weather, and one is every meal. California offers both. I think it would be hard to live here full time. But to get away for a weekend, it's like going on vacation. It's like going to a fantasy land or something. I got Roger about almost 5 years ago, and I was dating a woman who had a chocolate lab. And I just loved this dog. And I thought, I should get one. So I went out and got the dog out of the newspaper.
You want to get it? Sit.
And then the girl and I broke up. And I ended up with Roger.
Wanna go in the pool?
Go get it.
Go get it.
You know, this is a real kind of silly companion. You know, instead of talking to yourself, you have someone to talk to.
Go get the toy.
Go on, yes. Go get it. Go.
Good.
Go get the toy.
Well, I wouldn't compare it to a human relationship, but it's certainly a beautiful one-way relationship.
Go get that ball. Go find it. Go on. Go get it. Go find it. Good. That's a good dog. Now do the breaststroke. Okay. Good. Okay.
You know they're filming. That's what it is. All right. I went to college because I was not a very good student in high school, but I fell in love with a girl named Stormy. And she was very intellectual and very smart, and she made me read The Razor's Edge. And it inspired me, and I decided to go to college and acquire knowledge. And I did, and I studied philosophy, and it changed my life. Studying philosophy definitely influenced my comedy because it gave me a sense of the absurd. And, you know, I studied I remember studying Lewis Carroll in logic and reading those, they were called sorites, these little complicated logical syllogisms in a way, not syllogisms, but for the sake of what we're talking about. And they were hilarious. They really made me laugh because they were absurd. And it just gave me a sense of the absurd.
At 21, Steve Martin started off as a comedy writer for American TV shows like The Ken Berry Wow Show and Sonny and Cher's Comedy Hour, before going solo with his own distinctive brand of stand-up.
Early on, my act was very wild. I would play colleges, I would take the audience out into the street. Once I asked them to get into a swimming pool, a dry swimming pool, I found an empty swimming pool on campus and I would swim across the top of them. And it was a very experimental time. And it was new, I knew it was new. And I had no fear.
Steve had a lot of tough times on the road. He would perform to audiences that would boo at him. He would perform in front of drunk groups or stoned out rock and roll groups who just didn't get it. He did that for a few years. It was very demoralizing. And had he not had the stick-to-itiveness, you know, to stay with what he was doing, he might not have ever seen that cult following start to creep into his concerts. All of a sudden, there'd be a few people in the front row with arrows through their head.
I do have to tell you, when I realized that Steve was famous, he was doing a show at San Jose State when they were going to open their new event center. And in the past, my husband and I had gone to many of his shows where we were the only ones in the audience. We got to the event center and people were wrapped around the building, and I thought, gosh, I wonder who else is on with him. Then I started seeing these kids with their bunny ears and their glasses and the funny noses and realized they were there for him. He came out in his white suit. The audience was absolutely wild. It was standing room only. Kids were in the aisles. They were everywhere. They knew his routine, forward and backward. It was the most incredible thing I've ever experienced. But I'll never forget it. He had arrived.
Boy, those are good seats up there.
I thought, everything is political. Every comedian is political. It's all about the Vietnam War. It's all about Nixon. It's all about anger. And I thought, that's going to be over soon, and I'm going to be right there. And I'm going to be silly.
Because I am a wild and crazy guy!
When he was a young man, he never thought he'd see people stand in line to see the boy king. How'd you get so funky? Did you do the monkey?
Born in Arizona, moved to Babylonia, king.
Dancing by the night.
I first became aware of Steve when he was this unbelievable, you know, popular phenomenon. And on the set of Happy Days, which was in full gear at that point, everybody was talking about Steve, doing imitations of Steve. Even the makeup artist, Bruce Hutchinson, you couldn't get in or out of the makeup chair without him, you know, either playing a Steve Martin tape or trying to do a wild and crazy guy for a couple minutes. I mean, he was just everywhere.
I mean, it was like Dada. I mean, like years ago when the arrow through the head combined with just all that, you know, it was the wild and crazy guy, all of those things that were just pushing the envelope of just taking stand-up jokes, but not jokes, you know, kind of really making people kind of go, what is this, you know, absurdist.
Do you ever wonder where all the farts go?
Well, I'll tell you. They go up into the atmosphere,
and they form the fart zone. It's right above the ozone layer. And this is why we have to protect the ozone layer.
And he had got his comedy to the stage of auditoriums like a rock star. He said, but there was nowhere to go. He said, they were all laughing and screaming and I was just talking. And I thought, time to move along. So he went and did something else. Now, I would have carried on in the auditoriums, being the sort of comedy Led Zeppelin, but he decided, no, that's over, over here now, to do something else. It's that brain of his, it just keeps moving along.
What a great place. You know, you can tell so much about a person from the way they live. Just looking around here, I can tell you're a genuinely dirty person. What do I do with this? Oh, you keep it there. Where's your garbage?
I love The Jerk. I think it's a classic. It's one of my favorite films. It's disarmingly silly, and it's very fresh, and like a lot of Steve's comedy, it's almost like the character he creates is so classic American funny loser character, but it's optimistic too. It's got a kind of positive side. It isn't a pity me, poor little me. It's got a fighting back quality, which is very American and very acceptable to watch, I find.
With Martin's second film, a big screen remake of Dennis Potter's Pennies from Heaven, he was applauded for his singing and dancing performance. But the film confused many fans of the wild and crazy guy and was a box office flop.
You just can't do a movie like Pennies from Heaven after you've done The Jerk. And I knew that at the time. I mean, in terms of commercial success. I knew that at the time, but I thought, you know what? 20 years from now, or 10 years from now, they're not going to remember Pennies from Heaven was my second movie after The Jerk. It's just going to be another movie, and it'll be a really good movie.
Exercise is very important to me, although I'm never aware that I'm really doing it because I like to do fun things. Gives me time to myself, and keeping in shape is just good for your life, especially if you're single. I started rollerblading about 6 months ago. I learned it in Central Park in New York. It's a nice, speedy way to get around. It's a way to be out in public without being too vulnerable, and I get to look cool. Being a celebrity is sort of a mixed blessing sometimes because you get access to many things that you ordinarily wouldn't get. People you wouldn't get to meet, places you wouldn't get invited. It's kind of a special life, and there's I wouldn't call it a dark side, but sometimes an unpleasant side of being intruded upon when you don't want to be. You know, that's just part of the game. So you learn how to do it, and you learn how to try to be nice to people, unless they're rude to you, and then you try to be nice to them anyway. Once I was riding in Central Park in the summer, it was a beautiful day, it was a holiday. There were lots of people out, people on bikes and walking and lovers, and there were some kids, about 14 or 15, riding their bikes, and they were being very rude, and they were swearing, and they were scaring people on the bikes, riding up behind them and making noise, and I thought, oh, please don't notice me, please don't notice me. So he comes up, I pass them, and kid comes up and does his little scary thing and tries to, you know, make me fall off or something. And so I look at him and I say, oh, fuck you. And then he notices me and he goes, oh, it's Steve Martin. And then he follows me through the park and points out, and it's just really annoying. And I was
unhappy. So now about 2 days later, I was walking in the night in New York City. It was a beautiful, humid night, walking with a friend, and a teenage girl came up to me, about 16, and she said, Oh, remember the kid you said fuck you to in the park? I'm his sister.
If you want to shoot Steve, never shoot him in close-up. Because there's so much going on with the body, you have to shoot him like a dancer. Otherwise, you don't get the whole funny side of it, because a lot of his comedy is not just in his face like or his words like a lot of comedians. His body language is funny. He has one of the funniest body languages in movies, like Chaplin.
I love to do physical comedy, and it's something that goes from your brain to the tips of your toes and your fingers. Ha! Oh! And people who do it, like, I can see that in Jim Carrey, too, that he's operating every muscle in his body, and Jerry Lewis. It's fun. When it's right, you can just feel it.
After the failure of Pennies from Heaven, Steve Martin returned to the extreme comedic character of The Jerk with The Man with Two Brains and Dead Men Don't Wear Plaid, although both fell at the box office. But All of Me, co-starring Lily Tomlin, was a turning point for his acting skills, providing a comedy classic in the process.
I'm a big fan of Steve's work, and one of my favorite Steve movies is All of Me, which is an extraordinary demonstration of his virtuosity, really. Very few people could do the verbal humor as well as he does it, but on top of that, he lays this incredible physical performance of this body that is split in half. And it's fall down, cry, funny. Oh,
you seem to have control over the left side of your body, while I feel dominant on the right. Oh, let go of that.
Ow! Oh, you bitch! How about a little respect for the deceased?
It was a great surprise to people that he turned out to be such a good actor, having been such a gifted comedian. And then I think it might have been a surprise that he was such an amazing writer. If you look at Roxanne, which is just a kind of perfect screenplay.
Quite a hood ornament you got there, pal. Oh, here it comes! 3D coming at you!
I really admire your shoes.
What?
I love your shoes.
What do you mean?
And I was just thinking that as much as I really admire your shoes, and as much as I'd love to have a pair just like them, I really wouldn't want to be in your shoes at this particular time and place.
Ow!
I think Roxanne's my favorite of all his movies because I love the original play. And what I think is so clever is the way that Steve and Fred Skepsy have managed to parallel some of the main incidents in the original play in the movie. For example, the big sword fight at the beginning. And he just defends himself so beautifully. It's immensely witty, but you also see how beautifully he moves.
Oh, oh, oh. 15 love.
Oh, my nose.
Okay,
oh.
Come on. Come on.
I felt something afterwards that I had never felt in my career, which was respect. You know, when you're a comedian, you're like very funny, but it's not regarded and it's not respected. You kind of, it's like, people look at I've heard a de Kooning painting, and they go, well, my kid could do that. I'm talking about people who don't know about art. But then when they see that he could actually do extremely fine, realistic drawings, they go, oh, he has talent.
This is the tale of the pup, tale of the pup.
It's a hot dog stand in Los Angeles near the Beverly Center in the heart of town. It's actually one of the opening images of LA Story. One of the great things I like about working with Steve Martin is that he refers to all kinds of stuff in the culture, you know, trashy stuff, cultural stuff. This was a reference to La Dolce Vita. In the opening of La Dolce Vita, there's a helicopter carrying a cross over the city. This featured as a big hot dog being carried by a helicopter over Los Angeles.
La May.
A hot dog stand in the shape of a hot dog moves across the frame, suspended from chains attached to a helicopter. Driveways jut out in front of their houses in perfect symmetry. In slow motion, the occupants simultaneously appear out of their front doors and balletically retrieve the morning papers in perfect time with the music.
La May.
A four-way stop shot from overhead, a car waiting at each sign. Then simultaneously, they start across the intersection and smash into each other. Tied on the face of Harris K. Telemacher, he is outdoors exercising.
My name is Harris K. Telemacher.
I live in Los Angeles, and I've had seven heart attacks. All imagined.
I have a favorite quote about L.A. by William Shakespeare. He said, "This other Eden, demi-paradise, this precious stone set in the silver sea, this earth, this realm, this Los Angeles."
L.A. Story was an absolute triumph of observation. Especially when he said, he had a passenger in the car, and he said, "Excuse me, it's time to shoot the gun." There was a lot of people being shot in the freeway at the time, randomly by other people. There was a couple actually in the air shooting at one another at one point from private airplanes. But he just leaned out the window and shot at nobody in particular. It was so incredibly topical at the time.
No gun etiquette.
Hey, you son of a bitch!
I was kind of intimidated by the script of L.A. Story, to tell you the truth. There was a quality in a comedy script that I hadn't seen before, and it's just this range of reference that he is a stand-up comic, he's a physical comic, he can't help doing pratfalls and stand-up one-liners. And at the same time, there's a very serious philosophical guy inside who's not afraid to make references that some people might not understand.
Famous for so long, and you know, he's like a brand. He's like the Coca-Cola logo or Nike or something, because he's always looked this way, you know? So he can't really hide. In order to have some privacy, some peace, I think he's developed this persona that's very quiet.
Very good. Took a while.
And even in the company of friends, in an intimate setting, I think there's a part of him that wants to not be on. You know, I think it embarrasses him, the cliche of a comic who is always on.
If you feel the slightest bit of pressure to be funny, then I just clam up. You know, I do find sometimes that people laugh at serious things I say. I go, why did they laugh at that? I guess they're seeing something funny in it. I don't know, to me I'm just a guy, but, you know, I don't think I'm too moody, but probably a little bit. Not moody, but a little distracted, you know, sometimes thinking.
He was married when I met him, and I do think that being single has made him more personal, more able to be hilariously personal about his own vicissitudes, dating, and things like that, that give you the illusion that someone is being more open with you.
Okay, Roger, we're gonna do this three more times. All right?
And there's no question he is more open and he's more candid about himself.
It's right out there. Okay, ride the wild surf. Ride the wild surf, Rod.
The truth is that Steve has wanted to make great movies, and he's been willing to make not great movies. He's wanted to have a sustained career, and he's wanted to have the power which frees you from, you know, you're no longer a victim to the assholes. That's the bottom line. You know, no one who has a sustained career wants to be at the mercy of the people who run the business. So in order to not be at their mercy, you have to have a certain kind of success. And Steve, I think, is terribly frightened of being considered some refined taste that people don't want to see. He wants to be a popular artist. And I think that has drawn him in all kinds of directions.
Playing a concerned father in 1989's Parenthood signposted that the once anarchic comedian wanted to take his film career and comedy in a new direction.
He's out of there!
Parenthood was the breakthrough for Steve, both for himself and also for the public and the rest of the creative community to really accept the idea that here was this brilliantly absurd physical comedian, but that he could be accessible to everyone as a regular guy, as an everyman. And so when he bridged that gap, you know, I think that was exciting for him.
And in the early 90s, with Father of the Bride and its sequel, Steve Martin further established his regular guy persona, scoring his most profitable hits at the US box office. But while he continued this middle-brow direction with films like House Sitter, he disappointed many of his earlier fans.
Steve confuses a lot of people. The wild and crazy guy was wonderful, and the jerk was great. And then he comes along and does Father of the Bride or Father of the Bride 2, and people say they don't like it. But ask the teenagers in this town if they liked it. They loved it. He was playing to a different audience completely.
There's a beautiful article in, I think it was the New Republic, and I think it was by Greg Easterbrook, I'm not sure, on kind of high and low, middle brow. And he was talking about the virtues of middle brow, because middle brow is what we all are, and it's in a way, unless we're college students or film experts, what we want to see when we go to a movie. We want to laugh and be entertained and be involved and not be bored and not be made sick. And I think that's what those movies are. I think those movies will last a long time, like Father of the Bride.
Mom, don't wait up, okay? We might stop for a cappuccino.
Oh, okay, fine. Well, good night, Brian.
Good night. Good night, Mr. Banks.
Oh, you can call him George. Or Dad.
George will be fine.
Okay. I'll say it next time I see you.
Drive carefully. And don't forget to fasten your condom.
Dad!
Seatbelt! Amen. Amen. Seatbelt. Yeah.
And I'm putting your father to bed. This has been a very big night for him.
Bye.
Well, yeah. Good night. Have fun.
Good night.
Bye.
Bye-bye.
I think to understand Steve's movies, you've got to look at the credits. And if he's on as producer or writer, then he has had a lot of input. And that will make it much more a characteristic Steve Martin movie. Then he does the others, the Father of the Bride movies, where he comes along as an actor and does his damnedest to make it work. But basically, he's there as an actor, and I don't think he has the sense of responsibility, artistic creative responsibility, that he does when he's involved at the script stage. And I think the main reasons that he used to do those movies, apart from the fact that he genuinely enjoys working, is that he just does have the most phenomenal collection of modern art. And you need a little bit of money to buy hoppers.
Steve has collected art since the beginning of his career and has amassed a collection that includes works by many of the world's most famous artists.
found out the way it
From what? Say it again.
I found out how Monsieur Ang made his portraits.
Uh-huh. You're not going to do it live at the edge of the Grand Canyon?
Oh, I'll go and draw again. Yeah.
Yeah. So the drawings came from the visit?
Yeah, I did the drawings there. Yeah.
So great. And daring.
A darker wall, mate.
Yeah, yeah. For which part of it? Oh, I see, yeah, yeah.
That's going to the National Gallery of Australia.
Uh-huh. You have a water lilies effect. Wrap around.
Look how he's painted the blouse, sort of translucent. You can just make out her breast underneath, and it's, you know, sort of touching him about here. It's really pretty torrid, don't you think? Then, of course, you have the onlookers peeking at them from behind the doorway like they're all shocked. They wish. Yeah, I must admit, when I see a painting like this, I get emotionally erect.
In 1996, Steve Martin premiered his first play, which has become a firm favorite on the American repertory theater circuit. Set in a Paris bar at the turn of the century, Martin depicts science and art meeting in the shape of a young Albert Einstein and Pablo Picasso.
Do you know why the sun doesn't revolve around the earth? Because the idea is not beautiful enough. If you are trying to prove that the sun revolves around the earth, if you want the theory to fit the facts, you have to have the planets moving backwards and the sun doing loop-de-loops. Too ugly. Way ugly.
So you're saying that you bring a beautiful idea into being?
Yes, we create a system and see if the facts can fit it.
So you're not just describing the world as it is?
No, we are creating a new way of looking at the world.
So you're saying that you dream the impossible and put it into effect?
Exactly.
Brother!
Brother!
What I had to say was that at the highest level of creativity in art and science, the process is the same. That Einstein made the same leaps as Picasso at their highest level. That in science, you presume it's deduction that's getting you from place to place to place. But the big accomplishments were pure artistic creative thinking, where they had almost nothing to go on except an instinct and an understanding and a genius that took them light years ahead of everyone else.
As well as Picasso, Steve Martin has written three surreal shorter plays, all dealing with a personal philosophical world largely absent from his films.
Those particular plays, which are deeper, more painful plays, not only came out of my marriage bust-up, but also experiences I went through subsequently. You know, the marriage breakup was the beginning of the opening of a bottomless pit. And then subsequent events sent me lower and lower and lower that I had to recover from. It was a kind of a midlife crisis.
This is an excerpt from a play I wrote called The Zigzag Woman, and it's about three men reminiscing about the loves of their life. And this is the older man giving his reminiscence. His wife, he was saying that he had missed his wife, and someone asked him how long she had been gone, and he says 23 years. She divorced me, married an actor. In the beginning of something, its ending is foretold, and we met at an elevator going down. After she left in my travels, I would sit in hotel lobbies expecting her to appear, telling me what a mistake she'd made. I would land at airports thinking she got my flight number and would be waiting for me. When I went to a show, I would buy two tickets in case she had found out where I was and would quietly join me, nothing having to be said. I never figured out why she went away, but I did figure out this. Love is a promise delivered already broken.
He's driven by the same thing of just pushing the perception of what he can do. People know him as one thing, like as what he started, and like you said, outrageous, you know, outrageous characters. But then what he's capable of is something, you know, he's capable of anything. That's what I've seen. And like playing the role in Grand Canyon, Spanish Prisoner, he's just trying. I think he's also kind of sampling, trying everything. I think he's trying all those different things because he's just pushing the perception.
Where's the shot?
What shot?
You took out the shot.
Which shot is that?
The money shot.
bus driver's head. The brain's on the window shot. The viscera on the visor shot.
Davis, we thought we'd show it to you like this, you know, without all the...
Put it back. Don't show me anything.
You don't need it. But you're not even giving it a chance.
How's the rearview mirror gag supposed to work without it?
I felt that he was a terrific actor.
Am I the only one here who respects the writing?
He rarely had been put into roles that... I mean, maybe he, where how complex he is was actually used, you know? He, even his own comedies tend to put him into a very wild, caricatured kind of part, or the Steve Martin persona, you know, which you see in L.A. Story and a few other movies like that. But what I had not seen was him take on a straight acting part.
Mac. You ever seen a movie called Sullivan's Travels?
No.
That's part of your problem, you know. You haven't seen enough movies. All of life's riddles are answered in the movies. It's a story about a man who loses his way. He's a filmmaker like me, and he forgets for a moment just what he was set on Earth to do. Fortunately, he finds his way back. That can happen, Mac. Check it out.
You have to do something that you do care about in some strange way, that touches you. And Steve does what touches him. Sometimes he does a movie as an actor for money. Sometimes he writes a beautiful play. Sometimes he writes little pieces for The New Yorker, for which he probably gets the price of a Chinese meal. He has to do what he's moved to do at any given moment. That's the only way you get real quality.
And with the American release of Bowfinger, co-starring Eddie Murphy and Heather Graham, Steve Martin has enjoyed the best critical response to one of his films since Roxanne. Critics have praised his screenwriting skills, and the film, which opens here next month, has been a hit in America and confirms his re-emergence as a comic genius.
This is the New York world premiere of Bowfinger. And to prove that it's a fantastic movie, a lot of celebrities will come, and models. If you have models and you have celebrities, then you have a very, very important movie.
I love you so much.
I love you.
Oh, I'm so alive.
That's the word, alive. I've never been alive until now.
Never till now.
But I worry about our age difference.
What is age? It's a state of mind.
That's the way I feel.
Who cares if when I hit my sexual peak you'll be 70?
I know. It's Bogey and Bacall.
Who?
Steve is California. Is this light? Is this I thing that you get here, this 8-mile stare that everybody develops in this funny light, is the Beach Boys. Is when the plane's coming into LA, I find myself going round, round, get around, I get around. But he looks like a Beach Boy. He is that thing, that California product.
I look at all the films I've done, and I can be kind of cynical about it, and think that, you know, there's not really a great film among them, but, and I think, but there's some darn good clips. But sometimes when I'm in a different mood, and I look at the films I've made. I made about, I guess, 25 or 26 films. I can think, like, 12 of them actually were pretty good. And that's pretty good odds. Thank you.
And Steve Martin stars as a con man turned miracle worker, persuading the punters to make a leap of faith here on BBC One at 20 past midnight.
Is planning new services for the future. A children's channel is just one of them. Find out more and feedback your views by visiting our 2000 and Beyond website, or calling for a consultation pack and questionnaire.